we're ready to round out the week by defining the quantum Fourier transform, or QFT. I suggest a light reading of the definition of the classical DFT before you start, as this is the foundation for the QFT. Even if you didn't study the deeper meaning of Fourier transforms in the three previous chapters, simply knowing where the DFT's definition is and what it says will be a good bookmark for today's reading. This is about the point at which you might be thinking to yourself, I'm hopelessly lost in a forest of Fourier formulas. I think I can help you there. You really only need to do two things today, and even if you forgot everything you read up until now, these two things will enable you to follow the essentials of any quantum circuit that uses a QFT. First, think of the QFT as just another unitary operator on a Hilbert space. I'll define it three equivalent ways, and you'll be able to choose any of those as your personal favorite. Second, consider the QFT as a basis transforming operator. Every unitary transformation converts the z-basis to another orthonormal basis. For the Hadamard operator, that other basis was the x-basis. For the QFT, we get something called the Fourier, or frequency basis. One more time, the QFT is just a gate, and we can use it to measure any ket along the frequency basis. As you read, it'll become clear which very few pages contain these two nuggets of wisdom. Now let's take a closer look at a few highlights. We gave a formula last time, which you can look up if you skipped, for the DFT, a linear transformation that mapped n-dimensional vectors to other n-dimensional vectors. The most instructive way to picture the new QFT is to lean on that past definition as follows. Every ket in Hn has 2 to the n coordinates, so apply a 2 to the nth order DFT to those coordinates and you'll get a new vector also with 2 to the n coordinates. Those new coordinates define the output ket of the QFT. Just form the Hilbert space vector using them as the 2 to the n amplitudes, and that's that. In taking this approach, we've defined an operator, the QFT, by describing what it does to any one of the infinitely many states in our Hilbert space. Knowing what it does to the coefficients of a vector is everything. For those of you who want to add some mathematical rigor to this definition, follow along as I demonstrate that the formula results in a linear, indeed a unitary, operator, a fact that must be verified when proposing a coordinate-based definition of an operator. You may also like to see two equivalent definitions and meet the QFT's matrix. Then, there are a couple properties of this new operator that you can either accept at face value or compare with the corresponding properties of the DFT. After the definition, the other thing I mentioned was the basis transforming aspect of the QFT. Well, we already know that any unitary transformation, any quantum gate, can be viewed as a basis change tool. Unitary matrices take orthonormal bases to other orthonormal bases. The Fourier basis is, by definition, just the 2 to the n kets you get when you apply the QFT to the preferred basis. Now, the interpretation of that new basis as a way to measure some function in terms of its frequency falls into the optional category, but it's not overly difficult to see if you try. Next week, we'll be looking at an ordinary function of the integers, and we'll use its functional values to produce a state vector. We'll then send that vector through some gates, one of which will be the QFT. Because we based the QFT on the DFT, the output ket will contain frequency information about our original function. And what is frequency? It's just another way to view a function's period. And period finding is our ultimate goal. Over half of this chapter is devoted to building the QFT circuit. I won't lie to you, it's not for the faint of heart, and it's most definitely not required reading. While it does contain every step and progresses very carefully, it simply may take too much time. So skim it lightly and make your way quickly to the final subsection, which reveals the QFT's spatial complexity. We need to know that so we can estimate the overall complexity of Shor's algorithm, or any algorithm that uses the QFT in its circuit. Well, that's it. After today, you'll be prepared to face our final and most demanding quantum algorithm, Shor's period finding. If you have a reasonable understanding of Simon's algorithm, and read today's QFT chapter with the emphasis on the points I outlined, you will be ready.